So my name is Tia Rich. I am happy to be the director of the Contemplation by Design program. Welcome to this third session in the 2017 Contemplation by Design Summit. Yesterday we had our opening session and then a dynamic conversation on compassion in healthcare. And today we are very grateful to have Dr. Murphy Shigematsu take us deeper into the topic of heartfulness. We will continue the program this evening with Rick Hansen, the author of The Buddha's Brain, if you're free and interested in coming to that event. And then the week continues through November 9th with concerts and lectures, including Alice Walker on the 8th in Memorial Church and a concert in Bing Concert Hall as the grand finale of the program. If you're not familiar with the schedule, please help yourself to some of the flyers that are available at the two entrances to this room. Without further ado, it is a great honor to introduce my colleague, Dr. Stephen Murphy Shigematsu, who teaches here at Stanford, has written a book that's forthcoming in January, and it is a pleasure to have him share his wisdom with you. Thank you.
こんにちは、マーフィー重松です、今日はもちろんずっと日本語で喋れないけど最初はちょっと日本語で、混乱させるために、日本語が分からない人たちの、混乱させるためにちょっと日本語、話したいと思います、皆さんまだ落ち着いてないと思うんですけれどもできるだけ、マインドフルになってほしいんですね、要するにこの瞬間の自分に、注意を、向けてほしいんですね、できるだけ、早くマインドフルになってほしいんですね。Well, you know what I'm saying. It's basically just trying to get your attention and to, you know, ask you to be here in a way that we often find very difficult as people to actually be present in a moment. AndThis is something that I think we have a, We have a lot of teachers that can have told us about the simplicity of simply being present and how much that is the foundation of us being part of something that we are experiencing and really bringing ourselves to that moment as much as we can. And we know that that's something that's really difficult for us to do. But that's basically the foundation of what I call heartfulness. And the heartfulness, the meaning of it, I think you can see if you look at this character of Chinese origin that in Japanese is called nen. And it consists of the two parts, one of now and the other of the heart. So it's that sense of presence. Can you really bring yourself as a whole person into a present moment to really experiencing what is going on? And we know this from ancient wisdom of Lao Tzu, you know, that if you're depressed, you're probably living in the past. If you're worried, you're probably living in the future. But if you're peaceful, then perhaps you really are present in this moment. And we know it because people like us like to do, the universities like to do research and prove things that we've known for quite a while. But we like evidence in universities. And so we have studies that show that actually half the time we are not mindful. We're not very present. We're somewhere else. Our minds are not really there. But this is again something, if you've been reading Peanuts like I did since childhood, then you knew that Snoopy could tell you that this is so. If your mind is wandering, then it's a troubled mind. And this is the kind of thing that we have shown through empirical data, you know, that the troubled mind is a mind that leads to less well-being. And so we can measure that kind of thing. But we've had these kind of guides like Snoopy and our own dogs. You know, if we can look at our own dogs, we know that our dogs are very mindful. Our dogs live in the present moment. When we take them for walks, we know that our minds are full of all kinds of things, worrying about the past or what the future or all the things that we have to do and not really being mindful. And this is the joy of children too, that when we're with children, we know that a child is present in that moment. When they're playing, You know, when they're doing something and they can open us to that wonder of what is actually right before us in that present moment. Because we're often totally unaware of what is right in front of us, but that the child sees that. And so I'd like to invite you to be in this, where we have a very short time together, with a few words from Japanese that some of you may know. And the first one is the Shoshinsha no Kokoro. So the beginners, and Kokoro is a word that has been translated as mind into English, but often really means the heart, or it means a whole more holistic sense of the mind and the heart. And so there's a saying in Zen that if in the beginner's mind there are infinite possibilities. You know, and this is something that Steve Jobs talked about when he lost his job, and saying this is the first time he felt this creative burst came forward because he had a beginner's mind. He was no longer burdened with the weight of having to be, show how smart he was and always have things under control. And this is something, of course, our students feel as well, that tremendous pressure to always, this heaviness, that it can be released if they have this lightness of a beginner's mind. Another word I'd like us to begin with is Ichigo Ichie. And this is literally the one coming together, one moment and one meeting place. So one, the coming together in a moment in a way that is really will never happen again. And if you can bring yourself to any moment, even as mundane as a tea ceremony, just simply making tea, or coming to something like this, you know, an event at a university, a lecture, a talk, whatever it is, you've been to 1,000 already. But if you can bring yourself with a different way of thinking, a different way of being, can you feel like this is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity, which of course every moment in life is, but we rarely are aware of that. So if you could come with that sense that this is once in a lifetime. And this, if you think of the traditional tea ceremony house, something that the samurai used, the first thing that the samurai discovered was that they, to get through this little door, they had to bow. Right? They had to lower their head to get through that door, which was a great thing for the noble samurai. The next thing they found was they couldn't get through the door without taking off their swords. So they had to take off their weapons, their defenses. And so in a same kind of sense, I'd like to invite you to come into this space with humility for what might you might learn from each other, with a sense of taking off your weapons, the weapons that we bring when we come to be with other people, our defenses, the ways that our masks, the ways in which we feel we have to present ourselves to other people to be acceptable to them. To remove those kinds of defenses that you have, and that can be a kind of weapon that stands between connecting you and another person. So to get us, help us to get into the mood a little bit, I want to show you just a 1 minute video from one of my favorite films, which I think will give you this sense of this other word in Japanese, mono no aware, the sense of impermanence.
What else has she told you?
You have nightmares?
Every soldier has nightmares.
Only one who is ashamed of what he has done.
You have no idea what I have done.
Aramote. You have seen many things.
I have.
You do not fear death, but sometimes you wish for it. Is this not so?
Yes.
I also. It happens to men who have seen what we have seen. And then, I come to this place of my ancestors. And I remember. Like these blossoms, we are all dying. To know life in every breath, every cup of tea, every life we take, the way of the warrior.
Life in every breath.
That is Bushido.
So he says this is Bushido, but it might also be called in Japanese, ichigo ichie, the sense of bringing yourself to every breath, every cup of tea, every moment of life. If you can bring yourself to that moment, that's how you can get appreciation simply for the gift of being alive. The other word I think that is I'd like to bring to this moment is the sense of ma, which many of you know, describes the space, a space or an emptiness that exists between words, between musical notes, or you could think of it even as moments of life, right? The moments of life between one thing and another, which may often seem like complete emptiness, but the word ma indicates, and if you look at the two parts of it, the sun and a gate. So the sense of the sun coming through a gate. So if you can have that space, it allows something to come in that would not be there otherwise. And so if you think of this moment now, this is a moment between different things that you're doing in your life, right? You're rushing from here to there. You're already still past in your past moment of looking for a parking space. You're already thinking about the next moment of when you're going to have lunch. But this might be that emptiness, the space between the things that you're doing in life in which you may actually receive something that you wouldn't otherwise. And the way that we often get to a state of mindfulness or heartfulness is through meditation. And some of you know that Stanford has recently made meditation a greater part, at least visibly, of the campus life by having the Windover Contemplation Center built right in the center of campus. And if you haven't been there, I'd encourage you to try to visit there sometime. But meditation is a way into mindfulness. It isn't mindfulness itself necessarily, meaning mindfulness is a whole way of being, a way of doing, a way of living, a way of trying to constantly have these principles in mind of being fully present in any moment, bringing your heart, your whole being into the present moment. But meditation can be a way into that space, and so I'd like to practice a little bit with you today if you're willing to do a short meditation with me. And this is a loving kindness meditation, and so I'd like to, this will take a few minutes, so if you would like to participate, please just begin by sitting in a comfortable way. There's nothing to look at, so if you feel comfortable, to close your eyes. And to begin simply by focusing your attention on your breath. If you're not comfortable with your eyes closed, then just keep them open a little bit and looking down halfway. But if you're comfortable to close your eyes, it's often helpful. And begin just by focusing your attention on your breath. Taking a deep breath in and slowly exhaling it out. Another deep breath in, exhaling slowly. Inhaling again deeply, exhaling. You may notice only with a few breaths you already feel a different sense in your body and your mind. You know, just breathing naturally. And bring your attention to your heart center, the area around your heart. If you can repeat these words to yourself. May I be well. May I be happy. May I be peaceful. May I be loved. Thank you. I be well. May I be happy. May I be peaceful. May I be loved. Bringing your attention again to your heart center. And if you'd like to put one hand or two hands over your heart, it might help you to focus on that part of your body and your being. You might already feel the warmth around your heart. Now, if you can bring to your mind the image of someone in your life who has loved you, cared for you, you might imagine that person sitting next to you or before you. You might repeat these words to that person. May you be well. May you be happy. May you be peaceful. May you be loved. May you be well. May you be happy. May you be peaceful. May you be loved. Bring your attention again to your heart center. Notice the feelings that may have arisen, the warmth around your heart. You might feel this moving through your body, through every cell, every part of your body. You might feel it coming out, emanating from your body as if it could touch the other person. If you can bring to your attention the image of someone who is sick, or suffering. And say these words to that person. May you be well. May you be happy. May you be peaceful. May you be loved. May you be well. May you be happy. May you be peaceful. May you be loved. Bring your attention again to your heart center. See what feelings have arisen there, the feelings of compassion. That you have extended to this other person. You can bring your attention back to your breath. Just be conscious of your breathing in and out. when you feel ready to open your eyes. I didn't know the storm was coming. That was unexpected. The music switched. One of the things that when I do this with students, they notice is that they say that when we do something mindful, they feel that they understand that you are more aware of yourself. Right? You're pulled inside, you feel, you're more aware of your thoughts and your feelings. But what most surprises them is that they are much more aware of others. So as soon as they open their eyes, they can't see themselves, of course, but they see the other people around them. And they've said remarkable things like, it's as if I saw my classmates for the first time. That the eyes with which they see them is very different from before they do any kind of meditative exercise or mindfulness exercise. And it reminds me of this, something that Thoreau said about after he was, you know, a very contemplative person, and the sense that he's never seen somebody who was really awake. And this is, of course, again, the kinds of things that we study in psychology about how much of our mind do we actually use? How often are we actually somewhere in being present in any situation? How awake are we really ever? How much do we have this sense that we go through life half awake and half asleep? Half being there, only part of us really being there. But sometimes through these kinds of contemplative exercises, we can feel the sense that we are much more awake. And just being awake means that we can be present there, not just to be for ourselves, but we can be much more present for other people. And there's one of the reasons that mindfulness is really something that has been done very much as a private thing. It's something you do by yourself. But I always do it in communities, and that I call it heartfulness because part of what we're doing is trying to extend mindfulness to compassion and responsibility. So which means we want to connect it with other people, you know, to really bring out that sense that what we are hungry for as human beings is to be connected. What we suffer from is the sense that we are an isolated being, disconnected from others, disconnected from nature, but we hunger for that sense of connection. So to do something mindful in community brings forth that sense that we are all really deeply connected. And so I look for these kinds of greetings that we have in different cultures that really acknowledge that sense that we are both here, we are both present. So Sawubona, that comes from South Africa, a Zulu word, which means that simply that I see you. And it also means that I am not just this alone, isolated individual, but I am we. I am here with my ancestors. We are here. And you are not just that isolated individual either. You are part of something greater. You are with your ancestors. You are with your people. You are part of something greater. I am part of something greater, you are too, and I see that. And if you think of the word see, or respect, comes from the Latin respicere, which simply means to see. So to think of that very deep sense of respect that is shown just by seeing someone else, seeing that person, or the greeting namaste, which is the sense of the divine in me recognizes, sees the divine in you. I don't just feel we are not just these two, Bob and Jim, but there's a divine being inside of me that sees the divine being in you. We see each other. Or the Hebrew expression, hineni, which has that sense of here I am. I am here. So that back and forth of seeing somebody and the other person acknowledging that they are there, that I am here for you. So what I would normally do is I'd ask people to get up and walk around, but this is not a good room for that. But what I would like you to do is, if you would just, it's kind of like church style, if some of you are Christians, but there's often a greeting, but to do it in the sense of that exchange of I see you and here I am. And then maybe the other person, go to greet the other person in that way. If you would try to do that with two or three other people, could you try that? Just to see the other person, even for a moment. Okay. Okay, you don't need to tell your life story, but just I know. But it actually happens, right? With just that moment of connection can often be enough to spark the sense, oh, we are actually connected, and I would like to tell you more, and the other person feeling, I'd like to hear more. Right? So just that sense of really connecting is what can really spark a greater sense of connection between people. And the next thing I often ask people is to reflect on who you are. And so we'll do the next exercise we'll do is asking ourselves who we are. And maybe I can, hopefully this will come up. I'll just show you a minute of a video to stimulate your thoughts.
Dave, tell us about yourself. Who are you?
Well, I'm an executive assistant at a major pet products company.
Dave, I don't want you to tell us what you do. I want you to tell us who you are.
Oh, all right. I'm a pretty good guy. I like playing tennis on occasion.
Also, not your hobbies, Dave. Just simple. Tell us who you are.
Maybe you could give me an example of what a good answer would be. What did you say?
You want Lou to tell you who you are.
No, I just, I'm a nice, easygoing man. I might be a little bit indecisive at times.
Dave, you're describing your personality. I want to know who you are.
I don't know what the hell you want me to say. Ooh. I mean, I'm sorry. I want to answer your question. Just not doing it right, I guess.
I think we're getting a picture, Dave.
So, with that stimulation, I'd like you to do this exercise. If you could find a person who you don't know well, and the other, you ask each other, Carol, can we do it together?
Sure.
Who are you?
I'm full of joy.
And then you ask me.
Steven, who are you?
I am a man. Who are you?
I am at Stanford as a faculty member.
And then you ask me.
Steven, who are you?
I'm someone who likes dogs. Okay. So you can say anything. Of course, there's no right or wrong answers. But the more you do it, you go back and forth, interesting things start to come out. Mm-hmm. Okay. So could you try this? Find somebody. You may have to move a little bit to find a partner.
Sorry, I wasn't quite ready.
That was fun.
I need to be deep.
No. if we had more time, we would go around and usually ask people, you know, what was the exercise like and what did you discover for yourself? And did something surprise you or, you know, that about what you said? And did something surprise you about what the other person said? And did you find a lot of connections, which is something, of course, we often find is that we find really, really deep connections with somebody who we didn't know at all and can be very surprised at those connections, and that those connections can be the source of really starting some feeling of that we are somehow not so separate as we might think and feel that we are as we move through our day. And then I usually ask people to look at this image, which is the photo image of a book that I wrote, and I think it describes for a lot of people the way that they feel about themselves. Who am I? And that sometimes you get this sense that this is the part, there's a part of you that you present to other people and saying, this is who I am. And we have all kinds of ways in which we always describe ourselves, what we do, our particular role, our affiliations, our job, something that your major, if you're a college student, something that quickly identifies you and something that is fairly safe too, that you can bring into the light, you can show other people. Now, this is who I am. But there's this whole other part of us, right? A half moon is not really a half moon. It's a whole moon. But part of it is hidden. Part of it is kept in the darkness, in a shadow. We don't reveal that. And often we're not very in touch with it even. We're not aware often of this other part of ourselves. But because what's in here can be all kinds of things. It could be way back to our early childhood in which we started to say, this is who I am, and other people said to us, no, that's not who you are. You know, you can't do that. You can't be that because you're a girl. You can't do that, or you can't be that because you're Asian. You can't do that. You can't be certain things. Or there's parts of you that are in here that are have been traumatized or wounded, parts of you that you would rather not be in touch with. Or they could be really good qualities too, that you have somehow have lost touch with. You're not remembering that this is really who you are. Or, you know, when we talk about authenticity, many people say you really don't want to be your authentic self because what if you're an asshole? Right? And to be a little vulgar, right? You know? But the belief here is that we're really born not as in that way. We're born whole and complete, but that the kinds of trials that we have in life start to make us much smaller, much more fragmented. And so returning to an authentic self is actually a good self. But we're often really out of touch with that, and we start to feel, too, that there's something about our broken parts that need to be hidden. Some of you know that there's this a Japanese art form called kintsugi. And the story is that someone received a very valuable bowl, and they dropped it. And then it shattered and broke into all these pieces. And they said, well, what a waste. I'll return it to the person who made the bowl, and they'll fix it. And they'll return it as good as new. So when he saw it, he was shocked. He thought, that's not what I expected. I thought all the cracks would be hidden, and it would not be visible anymore. No one would be able to see where it had been broken. Instead, the artist had highlighted them with gold, as so you could see all the places in which this bowl was broken. And it was, by putting gold on it, it was a way of showing that the parts of you that have been broken can be your most beautiful parts. You don't have to hide them. You can bring them out. You can show people, this is who I am. Yes, I am all of these things. These are parts of, I had these kinds of experiences in my life, and that's what's made me who I am. I don't need to hide them. In fact, I can even tell you that this is who I am. And there's many things from theology and also medicine that really help us to understand that those broken places can be the places from which we get our most strength. They're the places in which we have learned about living. There are some valuable lessons about how to live a good life, and that's what we have to teach. That's how we can teach other people, help other people who may be feeling something the same, similar to what we've gone through. But if we've been through it and we've been able to heal ourselves, then we have some power as a healer, as a teacher, as a parent, something that we can teach other people if we can embrace and make that part of who we are. Some of you who can read this see that this is the character for forget, and it consists of two parts. The top part is death. Right? The bottom part is the heart. So it gives that sense of, if you forget all of these parts of who you are, there's a kind of spiritual death. There's a way in which you are not really alive completely. If you are not in touch, if you've forgotten who you really are. And so there's this, the same is actually true for the character for busy. Right? So when I worked in downtown Tokyo, I worked in the university, people would greet each other with, you know, konnichiwa, how are you? And then the next one was always, isogashii desu ka? Are you busy? And just for kind of to tease them, I would always say, yeah, sonnani, I'm not so busy. And they'd always look at me like, what a, you know, a fool. You must be a fool, because that's the way we arm ourselves. Say, I don't want to get too involved in your life because I'm too busy. So that same sense of, if you're busy, you're also too busy, your mind is too busy, you're too busy to connect to other people, that's also a kind of spiritual death. But for this particular character, I think it's good to remember about what does it mean to forget? What is it that we might forget that might cause us to lose a sense of really being alive? So this is a scene from one of my favorite films with the kids.
That's not my father. It's just my reflection.
No. Look hard. You see, he lives in you.
So we have a few minutes left. I'd like us to do one more exercise. So if you can, again, if you find a partner, you might want to try a different partner this time, or you don't have to, it could be the same one. But just for a couple minutes to ask this question to the other person, what do you need to remember that gave you joy or satisfaction? And one of the ways you might think of this is that we often have really enjoyed something in our lives. Something that really gave us pleasure and really made us excited. It might be all the way to childhood. Something that really we felt very alive when we did it. And then gradually we've forgotten it. So often I do art activities in my classes and students say, wow, I haven't done art since I was in elementary school. But I used to really love it. I used to love to draw. There's so many things that we used to love. And we might even say, like when you say, who are you? You might say, I'm somebody who loves nature. And then you might think, well, gee, how often do I go to nature? I really don't do it very much. So for this exercise, if you could just think about what is it that really you have loved doing in life? Something that has really given you joy and pleasure. And somehow you have started to feel you don't have time for that. You can't do that anymore. Some reason it's not allowed. You don't allow yourself, or you feel others don't allow you to do that. So just if you will, just take a couple minutes because we don't have much time, but if you could just pair with one other person and just to have each person have a couple minutes to reflect on that. What is something that you want to remember that might help your life right now? Okay, I'll ring the bell after 4 minutes. So just 2 minutes each.
Doesn't matter. Right.
So we have a few minutes left. I'd like us to do one more exercise. So if you can, again, if you find a partner, you might want to try a different partner this time, or you don't have to, it could be the same one. But just for a couple minutes to ask this question to the other person, what do you need to remember that gave you joy or satisfaction? And one of the ways you might think of this is that we often have really enjoyed something in our lives, right? Something that really gave us pleasure and really made us excited. It might be all the way to childhood. Something that really we felt very alive when we did it. And then gradually we've forgotten it. So often I do art activities in my classes and students say, wow, I haven't done art since I was in elementary school. But I used to really love it. I used to love to draw. There's so many things that we used to love, right? And we might even say, like when you say, who are you? You might say, I'm somebody who loves nature. And then you might think, well, gee, how often do I go to nature? I really don't do it very much. So for this exercise, if you could just think about what is it that really you have loved doing in life? Something that has really given you joy and pleasure. And somehow you have started to feel you don't have time for that. You can't do that anymore. Some reason it's not allowed. You don't allow yourself, or you feel others don't allow you to do that. So just if you will, just take a couple minutes because we don't have much time, but if you could just pair with one other person and just to have each person have a couple minutes to reflect on that. What is something that you want to remember that might help your life right now? Okay, I'll ring the bell after 4 minutes. So just 2 minutes each. So if we had more time, we would go into the exercise again, processing it a little bit more. What did people experience through the exercise, and maybe do an art activity or something. But so some of the things that I think, when I think of remembering, I also relate it back to the first film we saw from Last Samurai, which was a sense of remembering that you are alive. Right? So that very basic sense, which comes from Bushido, the sense your awareness of your life every day, every moment. The fact that you are alive, and as he said, like the cherry blossoms, we are all dying. So that awareness of mortality, which often in life we feel we want to keep it as far away as possible. Right? There's something that makes us feel bad about that awareness. This way of thinking is very much the opposite. It's the sense that if you are really remembering, you're remembering who you are, that you are this living being that is dying, just like nature around us. And that awareness, rather than making you feel horrible and sad and terrible, it can make you feel very awake and aware of the preciousness of this moment, right? The time that you do have in this world, rather than the time wishing it was endless, wishing it was something other than what it is. So part of remembering is not just remembering the past, but it's remembering simply who you are in the sense of being a living being. So this type of heartfulness, mindfulness type of classes and workshops started for me at Stanford a lot when I was a resident fellow, meaning I lived with students for a few years. And this is when many of you have heard about the duck syndrome, became alive, when I could actually see students in their daily lives, right, in their pajamas, right? And to really see them up close and to see that, you know, much of what I had suspected, because I've been trained as a clinical psychologist, was really true. And I've been at some of these really what we think of as elite places like Harvard and Tokyo University and Stanford. And Stanford was very much the same. It was full of young people who in some ways seemed so self-assured, so confident, so powerful. And yet there's something there that's missing, I always feel. There's a sense that we're on our own now. We can't rely on our elders anymore. There's nobody older than us who really knows anything that's going to help us. You know, It's like a ship out of control, in the sense of there's nobody leading anymore. There's nobody who can we can really trust. And Stanford students, I found, have a great deal of difficulties. These are the kinds of problems I encountered among my students just in the first year. Anything you could expect, and this is something that we see all across the country at colleges. Students who are having a hard time just living, just being alive. Even those who get to these places which we have been telling them their whole lives, this is what you should want in your life. This is what's going to make your life good. If you can only get to a place like Stanford, life's going to be great. Of course, you get here and you find it's no different from anywhere else. The same things, concerns follow you. And the thing that really stood out to me was not these alarming statistics about how many students feel troubled, but that many of them won't seek help. So it's very hard to get people to get help if they don't want help and they don't see the system as really helping them. And so I felt that it made me much more aware of how the universities are not really serving the interests of the students who really need something or looking for something, an inner dimension of life. And this is true not just at Stanford, it's true at Harvard, where a former dean has talked about that universities don't have a soul anymore. It's true at Yale, where a former dean has said about how we've really lost the sense of a university as a place to explore life's meanings. And yet we know that students are hungry for it. People are hungry to find what is the meaning and purpose in their life. And they hope that they can get this at college, but they find they can't. They're thinking the same things that Snoopy is. You know, even at this level, he's just a dog, but our students are thinking the same thing. And they want a spiritual life. Right? They want to know that life is more than just getting to a place like Stanford, getting to a place like Google. There's a lot more, something you can get there and you still feel, what have I done? Where have I, what is my life all about? And even the happiness researchers now are saying that maybe it's not just about happiness. What we really are looking for is meaning in our lives. And that might not mean the kinds of happiness that we think about, but it might mean a different kind of happiness. The happiness that comes from serving others, the happiness that comes from being part of something greater than ourselves. And we know that this is something that is not just at a university, it's right all around us. The people that we think should be the happiest, they've got it so much. The kids in Palo Alto have so much, and yet why have so many of them decided to end their lives so early? So I have had this great desire just to ask people, what can we do to have people just feel more alive, more awake, more aware that this is their life, this is what they've been given. Maybe the best thing that I've heard so many times from people who are dying, the purpose is just to see what you've got and to do something with it, right? To do what you the best you can with what you've been given, and that might just be very simple. Many of our students are asking, what can we do that's the most meaningful thing in life? How can we make a biggest impact in the world? What does the world really need? So I love this expression by Howard Thurman. Just find what makes you come alive. And that's the purpose of those kinds of exercises that we do. Who are you? What makes you feel alive? What have you forgotten about what makes you feel alive? What is it, if you connected to it in your daily life, that you would feel more alive and you'd want to do something more with your life rather than to end your life? And so we started a program at Stanford, and it's called LifeWorks, and it's trying to develop, bring in this sense of heartfulness into any course. It doesn't have to be a course called heartfulness, but it can be any course, anything that we're teaching students to help them to bring this into their connect what they're learning with their life. And this was identified by a huge study here a few years ago. What is missing the most from even this great Stanford education? It was called integrative education. Students don't know how to integrate what they're learning in the classroom into their lives? How does that make meaning in their lives? I had a student at graduation with a 4.0 curriculum, GPA, meant he'd gotten all A's, and on the graduation day he was telling me, you know, I can't remember anything I learned. I said, well, we also know that from psychology that, you know, things that you've had to learn for tests, you do forget them pretty quick. But his point was, nothing I learned really was made, I didn't really put it into me. It didn't become part of who I am as a person. It didn't help me to make meaning out of things. I learned things in my head, and then I regurgitated them, and I got A's. But somehow it hasn't changed me as a person. It was very sad, actually. He was saying, well, I'll brag a little bit. He was saying the LifeWorks class really helped me, was the only class that really made an impact in my life, simply because it went into my heart. It came to a different place rather than simply in the head. It came into this greater sense of what is, in Japanese, the kokoro, this sense of mind and body and spirit all being together. And that's the place in which we have to try to appeal. But so this is the program that we have, and I want to recognize the person who has really driven it, Anthony Antonio. Could you raise your hand? Who has driven this program at LifeWorks, and now it's at the point where it's really going to be a program that is deeply integrated into the curriculum for undergraduates. But I'd like to end with this, just with this note about mastery and mystery of what we consider to be really appropriate to teach at a university, which is, of course, the mastery, the sense of control. What is it that we have learned to control about something even like nature? Right? So we take a butterfly, kill it, pin it, dissect it, cut it open, look at its different parts, and that's a scientific way of looking at something. The writer Goethe had another philosophy called gentle empiricism, meaning a scientific exploration in which you appreciate the wholeness of an object and you become one as much as possible with that object. You see the connections even between yourself and a butterfly. And that's by loving that object, connecting to that object, that was the source of the greatest scientific way of studying something. On the right, you have a butterfly, but this is a butterfly that I saw that actually existed. Some of you might know these twins who have been Stanford alum. They're called the names of Stenzel twins, Anna and Issa. They were 20 years ago. They were students at Stanford. They both came. They had cystic fibrosis that they knew from a very early age. They've said they saw hundreds, literally hundreds of their friends die because people with cystic fibrosis don't have a long lifespan. They both had double lung transplants, and they both came to my classes many times to share what is it like to live with the awareness of death throughout your whole life from childhood. Anna died, and I actually don't know which one is Anna, but Anna's one of those two. Anna died 3 years ago at the age of 41. But her mother had this great sense of gratitude that she had been able to live that long, because from childhood she thought maybe it's just another year, maybe it's just another 6 months, maybe it's another month. But it continued for 41 years. And when she died, we had a ceremony and we were given 100 butterflies live. And they were in these little boxes and they said, let's go out to the balcony and we'll release the butterflies. So we went out there and everybody opened their boxes, 100 boxes were opened, and 99 butterflies flew away. One butterfly didn't. This is the hand of her husband. But how do you talk about something like that at a university? We don't, right? We ignore it. We even ignore in the hospitals, the things that like this that are happening every day that we can't explain by what we know now about science. But if we could somehow bring this into our education, right? This one sense of wonder, awe, amazement, beauty, and to really feel that there's something in the humility of not knowing, right? and that how that can open us up to all kinds of knowing and explorations in life. Before Anna died, she told me that the two things in life that she felt were the most important, and when she spoke, I listened very closely because I thought she had learned something very deep. She said it was simply to be grateful, right? To be grateful every day, that sense that you're aware that you're alive, you're grateful that you have the gift of this life, even if it's just a short time, maybe if it's just even this one day, but to be grateful for that day. And the other was the connections, so that we live for connections. And that was more of a surprise to me, to think that, because we have this sense of rugged individualism in America, to think that somehow we can do it by ourselves, and somehow we have done it by ourselves. But to realize that sense that we're only here because of the love of other people. We only got here, and we only exist because of that connection with other people. And so to cherish those two things is something that guides my daily life. And I feel like it's something that I call heartfulness. It's a way of trying to really be connected with yourself, a sense of gratitude for the life you have, and a sense of connections with others, so that we don't feel alone. We realize we're not going through this alone, and it makes it a lot easier when we feel that deep connection with people around us, even who are complete strangers. So I want to thank you. It's time to go, or at least time for me to stop. And I hope that you have even just felt something. Maybe it's not clear in your head, but if you've felt something that might help you to feel more alive and more grateful for the life that you have, then I feel that I'm very happy to have spent this time with you. So thank you very much. Thank you.